Good morning, friends. I think this session is a nice continuity to the wonderfully inspiring talk that we heard of Mr. Kant earlier. We've had lots of enriching discussions since yesterday about innovation, thought leadership in various fields, right from big data to aggregators to new media. But I think the topic of this discussion will be very different, but at the same time, extremely important in a country like India, where even after 69 years of independence, I think a vast population lives in abject poverty. There is lack of basic human amenities, lack of healthcare, education, malnourishment, all of which plague a substantial part of our population. We try to shove this under the carpet with all the glitz and glamour of GDP growth and other statistical figures, but then the reality keeps staring in our face more often than not. And here I'm reminded of what Varghese Kurien, the milkman who almost single-handedly spearheaded the milk revolution and empowered so many women in rural Gujarat, had to say, that India's true place in the sun would come from the partnership between wisdom of its rural people and the skill of its professionals. And I think that has never been true than now, where we see a convergence of these two and these two areas of skills and also them helping in solving social problems. So this panel is going to talk about social impact and about social enterprises. So at a very simplistic level, social impact is the change in society that an organization creates through its interventions and actions, which largely impact the social fabric and also the well-being of the community. Social enterprises tackle these issues and also are financially sustainable, and they can scale up. I think these are some important parameters to define a social enterprise. And some interesting trivia is that in India has about 1 to 2 million NGOs, which also include several religious establishments and trusts and so on, which do not count as social enterprise. And currently, over 30% of social enterprises are less than 5 years old. So what we are seeing is a very nascent, at the same time, a very unorganized sector, but a sector with immense potential and talent, which has been untapped so far. So with these opening words, I'd like to open the panel to a very distinguished set of speakers who have made the mark in their respective areas. And I'd request all of you to briefly talk about your enterprise and what it does, a brief history and of your journey. In all of 2 minutes. Thank you. That's on.
Hi, my name is Kanika Pal, and I've been a CSR professional for a long time, and I quit sometime last year to start an organization called SOCH Foundation. SOCH stands for Solutions for Clean and Healthy Environment. Our work is primarily aimed at uplifting artisans from abject poverty, helping them create their handicraft in an environment-friendly manner, and at the same time help them get the pricing that a handicraft should demand.
Wow, that was really quick and brief. Yes, Shankar.
My name is Shankar. I'm one of the co-founders of an app called InClove. Comes from the two words inclusive love. What we do is simple. We are the world's first matchmaking app focusing on people with disabilities and health disorders. Our aim again is quite simple. There are 1.2 billion people on this planet with disabilities. Only 67% of them remain single. And we want to reach out to, you know, the 600-700 million people across the globe and find them, help them find that one person that they can go back to, you know, every day, or they can go back and text and give them the same feeling that all of us feel. And that's what we're doing.
Hi, my name is Deepak Goyal, and we run a company called Karma Circles. It's a peer-to-peer micro-mentoring platform wherein anybody can come onto the platform, search for another professional by skills, location, or specific affiliations, and then request time from another person on the platform. And the only expectation is that if you get free time from somebody on the platform, you will write a thank you note for the person. So it's as simple as that. And the way this whole thing works is that, you know, when you are actually taking time from somebody else on the platform, you are actually getting free time and free professional help. And when you are giving time to somebody, you are building your online reputation, because the thank you note that you give to the other person is public and searchable on Google. So what we are really building is, we are building a timeshare economy wherein the currency in which we transact in is actually online reputation. And you know, what we really believe is that if you do good karma, it will circle back to you, and it will mean more business for you even in your professional life. So we have mobile apps, and the whole concept is based on our research that if you make it extremely easy for people to help others, they are more likely to help. So that is what Karma Circles is. Thank you.
Wow. The other characteristics of social enterprises are, we stick to time. Harsha.
Hi, my name is Harsha Mukherjee. I started my journey from my MBA college itself. So I was told by the investor, well, you're married, you have three kids and all that stuff, so why would I invest in you? So I did not answer him back. But it was 2010 when I was looking for investments. And it is 2016 where I have created four companies, out of which three are sustainable. One is Institute, International Institute for CSR, which I created last year. It's an online education platform, plus we have an infrastructure there in place in Mumbai. We have a CSR consulting firm in which we have some top three builders whom we are consulting back in Bombay. And then we have a foundation which I started from. So that is, in short, my journey.
Thank you. So, Rabia.
Hi. Being the last speaker means I get less time than everybody else on stage, I guess. But I'll make it easy to remember. My name is Surabhi. You'll want to remember that because I'm going to be the first woman chief minister of Karnataka.
Oh.
In my current avatar, I am a political entrepreneur. Yes, we exist. I run Political Quotient. It's 3 years old. And basically, we help elected representatives, MPs, MLAs, corporators with their constituency development and election management.
Thank you. At the end of all of their introductions, I thought I'll introduce myself too. I wear two hats here. One is, of course, I head the Symbiosis School of Media and Communication in Bangalore, of which some of the young and enthusiastic volunteers you see in this room are my students. So hopefully I won't get that bell at the end of the time limit. But then I'm also the founder of India's first digital sound archive called the Archive of Indian Music. So like political entrepreneur, I think there's a new species we could have called cultural entrepreneurs. What Archive of Indian Music does is to save and restore the vintage music of India, particularly gramophone records. Now, every other country in the world has a sound archive, a national sound archive, whereas a country like ours, where music is so ubiquitous, we find that preservation and documentation of it is never considered important. And so with that in mind, I set this up in 2011 with seed capital from Mr. T.V. Mohandas Pai. And what we do is we collect gramophone records from different parts of India, which are lying actually in a state of extinction and damage in raddi shops and chor bazaars, which is where the valuable cultural inheritance of this country lies, and nobody cares a toss for our history and cultural heritage. So we bring these from these places to Bangalore, where the AIM is headquartered, and it is digitized and then uploaded on an open source SoundCloud for everybody to access free of cost. And we've collected already about 20,000 gramophone records from different parts of India. And thank you. And these cover classical music, folk music, theater recordings, early cinema, and also the speeches of leaders like Gandhi, Tagore, Nehru, all of which are found in chor bazaars in Chandni Chowk as well. So that's a brief about Archive of Indian Music, about which I will not talk after this, but move on to my next question, which I address to both Deepak and Surabhi. How do you think we can draw a distinction between the non-profit social efforts and for-profit efforts, because a social enterprise at the end of the day is not an NGO. It needs to sustain itself and be scalable, as I mentioned right at the beginning. So how do you see this playing out?
So I'll tell you that it actually gets very, very complicated when you start a social company or a social enterprise, because you go and say that, okay, it's not a non-profit. Because if you say it's a non-profit, they know that, okay, you're looking for grants and there are no expectations of returns. Mm. But when you go for a for-profit completely, like, okay, I'm building an e-commerce venture or I'm building a food tech venture, they're like, okay, you are completely driven by profits, so I'm going to invest in you. Now, when you go for social impact initiatives or social enterprises, then they are actually quite confused, or especially the investors or the, so fundraising becomes a challenge wherein, like, how do you convince them, like, okay, you know, yes, I am going to make some money for you. It may not be as massive as, what you will make in Facebook or Flipkart or anything else. So so the way we have dealt with that situation and the way I have seen some of the other organizations done this is, you have to bootstrap initially and you have to show a little bit of traction, which is when they're actually more excited. And they're like, okay, if this person can help 1,000 people without raising any money, if I pump in a little more capital, maybe he can help 10,000 people. So I think that is the way we have dealt with the situation, wherein we bootstrap with our initial money and then we got, like, you know, a few people who actually said that, okay, you know what, we are not in it for money. We really want to help you in your journey. And, but we have not raised, like, capital, like, you know, what you would expect from an e-commerce venture. And we have not taken any grants because we say that, no, we have intentions to make money. So that is the way we have dealt with that situation.
Yes, Surabhi.
I'm going to take that question in a different sense. I think when people hear political entrepreneurship, in fact, anything related to politics, the question of funding becomes extremely important. And in fact, the number of grants that I've applied for or any social impact ventures that I have spoken to have always come to me and said, politics, really, we're not funding you, because there's always that, you know, fear, that muck that they don't want to get involved in. I'd just like to say that being a social entrepreneur is about solving the most important problems, the biggest problems in the world. And whether you do it in a for-profit manner or whether you do it in a non-for-profit manner is just a matter of convenience, whether you choose to go the for-profit way or the non-profit way. At the end of it, it comes back to this. What sort of social impact are you creating? And from my experience, political entrepreneurship, something that's growing right now, is it's been something that's absolutely necessary. If I may just take a quick minute to, through a show of hands, understand how many of you here are from the NCR region? Fantastic. And how many of you have been cribbing about the waterlogging that's happened and the traffic that's... So have you been cribbing on Twitter, Facebook, social media? Right. The number of people who probably would have gone to their corporators, their officers, bureaucrats regarding this issue, can I get a show of hands on that? Great, fantastic. So, and I'm really happy to, see at least 3-4 show of hands. So, political entrepreneurship or any other entrepreneurship that is social impact based is basically solving these problems of governance, education, food, health. And I think that whichever path they decide to go in is a matter of convenience. Whether you want to be a for-profit or non-profit is just a matter of convenience. But the social impact part of it always needs to be remembered. There is some nobility to it. There is some sort of giving back, and there is some problem solving that is very relevant to people's lives.
People are not, like, very sure what they want, right? So after getting rejected by 75 of them, we realized that, you know, we are doing the wrong thing. We're going to the wrong kind of people. There are always people out there. It's not about for-profit or non-profit. I'm just saying that there, if you have a cause, you don't even need to convince anybody. Like, you just need to know that you are going to make money and this is how you're going to do it. And there will be people that believe in this cause, right? And they are the ones that will actually put in, you know, their belief more than their money. Because at the end of the day, even if they don't get like 5 or 10x returns, they know that this, you know, that this is serving a cause and this is serving a purpose. So.
Return that yeah, you're getting, yeah, you're solving, yeah, exactly, the problem.
Exactly.
That itself is
which I wanted to ask Harsha as to, you know, how exactly
be it profit, be it not for profit, impact, no impact. You have to be sustainable. You are not sustainable, you are not going to exist at all.
But then how exactly would you measure what is the social return of your, you know, enterprise?
For SROI, well, there are mechanisms for that. In India, it's not much existing. But in UK, social return on investment, there is a complete mechanism which we have to get in India and implement on all the social enterprises that we are running. Not only on social enterprises, but also the social projects that we do, none of them are measured. So it's just you keep on doing, but it is not measured. And if it is not measured, it's not done. You don't know.
So since it's so intangible, can you very briefly elaborate, how do you measure that? How is it done in the UK? I mean, how do people?
Well, there is, if you are investing in a SHG, for example, then the confidence level of a woman increases, her income increases, mm-hmm. her happiness increases, the family can afford a little more things. All these things can be measured. What was it before? Even a behavioral change in a human can be measured. Mm-hmm. How did a person react in this situation before? And now that she or she is in a self-help group and is able to sustain herself and is a part of inclusive development, what is the change from behavioral to economical to all round? So
right.
You have right. to take intangibles to be considered.
Yeah. Kanika would.
Yeah, I just like to build on both the points that you made. So essentially, SROI in India is actually measured in a lot of programs. With the new CSR law as well, the government is pressed on having monitoring and evaluation frameworks. IFC indicators are a very good starting point for people to measure their SROI, and there are enough corporates who are already doing that because that's the value that they want to showcase to not just their shareholders, but also their stakeholders. Just linking this very quickly to the profitability and the non-profitability, a lot of times, and considering that there are a lot of entrepreneurs to be who are sitting here in the audience, a lot of times we get really stuck in the semantics of the word. And what we don't realize is that we start looking at the whole situation from a very investor point of view. Essentially, what you need to understand is, where are you placed as an entrepreneur? What is your sense of purpose? And then bring that in the operations of your business. And if I can just quickly illustrate that through an example. When we work with artisans, and we work with artisans who are not in the mainland at all, I go to the border area around India-Pakistan, in Barmer, and they're working with Muslim women who are really, really a very vulnerable social group. These people have no idea about the kind of wages that they should be really demanding. And the distinction that one can make as an entrepreneur looking at impact is, do I give this person who has no idea about the wage any wage? A minimum wage or a living wage? And that makes a difference even on the impact that you're creating to begin with. And that sort of also then impacts the profitability at the end of the day on your operations. And the investor, if you're going for, doesn't understand this impact creation, then I think your choice of investor would also probably be a little incorrect. So therefore, just to conclude, I think it's very important that as an entrepreneur, you understand where are you standing in that scheme of things, what purpose or value addition you want to bring in, be it for your customer or for your stakeholders. And then also, probably look at investments, because it's a matchmaking at the end
right.
of the day.
Right. I think we've spoken about funding, we've spoken about returns, but what about talent management? And I throw that to both Deepak as well as Shankar. How do you in your enterprises manage to both, attract as well as retain talent? Because that's the main driver for your enterprise.
So, we at Karma Circles, we have taken a stance that every employee of the company will have equity in the company. And because, so this is actually very interesting because, I was shaking my head when Dr. Velumani was speaking yesterday, how when you don't have enough, how do you actually come up with creative ways? So we, as I said, we have not raised a lot of money. We have very little money in the bank. But what that does is that actually attracts the kind of people we really should have on the team, because anybody who comes to come to work for Karma Circles can actually make at least twice that amount of money in Flipkart or any other company, you know, because they are actually so talented and they're actually so hardworking that if they actually work anywhere else. But the reason why they come to work with us is because of the mission that we are on, the thing that, you know, they truly believe that we will make a much beautiful version of LinkedIn wherein people actually genuinely help each other. And so that is what we have done. The fundamental thing that we have done is we always pay them less than the market rate. Mm-hmm. What that does is that actually attracts the right sort of people. We always ensure that they get equity in the company. We always ensure that they're actually working much harder than anybody else. Actually, almost my entire team is here except one person, and we're like six in all. And can I have a show of hands from my team? And we have an iPhone app, we have an Android app, we have a website, and nobody actually believes that like just six of you run these three entire products. And I was on a podcast, which is broadcasted from San Francisco last week, and he could not believe it that our burn rate every month is less than $3,000. And he looked at the app and he was like, wow, it looks as sleek as WhatsApp. Hmm. And, you know, and I'm like, yeah, we take motivation from WhatsApp on how to build a company which serves 400 million people by raising way less than $50 million.
Right.
So, you know, I think it actually goes hand in hand. Because you have less money, you attract the same set of people. The other thing that we have also done is we have a lot of consultants helping us, which we could not afford anyways.
Okay.
And they do it again because of the mission.
Yeah. Shankar?
Actually, if you see, apart from the consulting bit, everything that he mentioned is very, very similar to a lot of the MNCs or any big company that is doing today, right? Who are not even in the social enterprise. And that's it. You know, I don't think it's any different from any other organization, right? You need to have like a very good story, like Mr. Velumani said yesterday, right? You need to have a very powerful story. Gaurav is with me today. He handles the marketing. He has been there since the time when my co-founder was matching forms physically with one another, right? So he has seen us grow from that point to today where we've had 1,000+ matches, right? And one marriage already in six months. So, I mean, for him, he has seen the kind of impact that we are creating in the world, right? At least in smaller ways that we can right now. And one is that you have a great story, right? It's after that, like how much you pay and not pay is come secondary, but as long as they believe in the story and want to contribute to the story. Secondly, guys, we just need to make it fun, you know? We just need to make it fun. What we do, we have things like Learning Saturdays, right, where every month we have somebody coming in from, you know, various parts. We want to get in people who are like just travelers and painters, people from the army as well, you know, not just like people in marketing and BD and things like that. Come in and talk to the team, you know, give them their experience. Everybody wants to come in for things like this. They want to learn, right? They want to grow. We have Bowling First Tuesdays, wow. Right? Last month was our like first official Bowling First Tuesdays. Now this Tuesday we're going to go for it again. So it's just about making it fun, and everybody's going to be there. It's not going to be any different from any other company, right? You just need to make it fun, make it like something that you want to work for, That's it.
If I may just add in, ours is a very niche field of people who have interest in politics and also the skills to contribute to politics and governance. So what we specifically do is when we hire as well, we are very particular about the type of people we want on board. That passion really has to be very pronounced. And how we retain talent is ensuring that their careers grow along with our company. And I think that is very valuable in a space that's pretty close. There are entry barriers. So just shadowing a politician, for example, and all of us at the company shadow politicians regularly, and they get so much out of it. So this is what, working for social entrepreneurship, this is what it's about. You really get to nurture that aspect of you that you cherish very much, the passion that you really cherish.
Just one more point, sorry.
I think we need to, yeah, sure. Okay, if you can make it in half a minute.
Yeah, about attracting and retaining talent, just very specific point. We also do these things called social spaces. It's basically, we want to translate it just from the app. We want to make it like a physical interaction. So we do these offline meetups, right? Mm-hmm. And we've done like one so far in quite a few cities. We want to now, a lot of people in these meetups have come to us, have told us that, you know, why don't you just make me like brand ambassador, let me do it, I'll show you how I'll do like 10 events for you in the city, you know. And you know, it's just because we're making these meetups also fun, and these guys are not, they don't want to be paid or anything, they just want to come and they want to make sure for them, like their social reputation, right? For them also that matters, and they just want to be there for us without being paid, and it's just about talent, right?
Kanika, I want to ask you, I mean, considering that you work, one, in a sector which is probably the second largest employing sector in the country, and also with women largely and artisans in Rajasthan, so what specifically are your strategies of your enterprise for inclusivity, which I think is very important in any social enterprise?
So artisans, yes, Rajasthan is one sector, the other is potters, primarily here in Delhi, which by the way is very close to where we are sitting. In Uttamnagar, and when we conceptualized Soch, we were very clear in terms of having inclusive growth as part of the strategy, and it's stated very boldly up there in our mission statement. For the next 20 years, we very clearly have stated that we're going to impact 10 million people, help them generate better livelihood options. We are going to help bring down 0.5 tons of CO2 equivalent in terms of emissions. And we are also going to influence 10 million people in urban and rural spaces for sustainable living. And everything that we do is centered around this philosophy. So I think inclusivity is something that you cannot be shoddy about. If you believe in it, it needs to be stated upfront in your company's goal. And everything that you do from there on will, without, you know, by default, end up being a part of the strategy. If I could just marry it sort of with some statistics, like you mentioned, after agriculture, handicrafts is the second largest employment generation in the country. There are 200 million artisans in this country who are involved in craft production. And in the last 30 years, we've already lost 30% of them. That's a huge number. And if we're not able to identify this as a problem, then I think we will never even be able to link this with the fact that when we talk of smart cities, when we talk of urbanization, when we talk of people moving from rural to the urban spaces, we are actually de-skilling a lot of these artisans who are coming to the urban spaces and trying to find a source of livelihood. So therefore, a lot of the work that we're doing is actually helping them to stay in their villages and become sustainable micro-entrepreneurs staying right there in those village sectors.
Right. Thank you. Harsha, I'd want to ask you, how do institutions like yours help prepare the next generation or even the current generation of social entrepreneurs going forward?
I would like to inform you all that next month we have an event on 1st and 2nd September wherein investors such as Will Grow, SBI Foundation, Marico Social Innovation, Omnivore, Omidyar are coming, and we would like to accept entrepreneurs who would like to pitch them. Apart from that, I believe there has to be an institutional change in this country because we have there are only 8% of women entrepreneurs in this country, and most of rest of them would take up jobs or okay
minus 10 in the assignment. Yes.
So rest of them would take up jobs. For India to actually have Startup India, we need to have more angel investors. We don't have angel investors, and we have far less venture capitalists in this country. In order for India to actually implement Startup India and Make in India, I believe we need to have more people who invest in the ideas. Thank you.
Yeah. So Ruby, I mean, I'd certainly want to ask the next woman chief minister of my state two questions. One is, of course, for being a woman who's entered, the political arena, how difficult has it been, particularly with the way politicians and political parties, view this phenomenon and of political entrepreneurship itself?
So it's really surprising that politicians are extremely adaptable. It might be surprising, but that's the truth, that they are very adaptable, and because their life is always at stake, they'll have to keep getting back voted to power, which also means that there's a lot of opportunity. What political entrepreneurship specifically does is that it always looks at the weakness in an existing system, a system of ideas, a system of the institution, of incentives, and whatever this weakness, inefficiency is, we propose new ways in which we can do stuff better. And the way we do it is not in an activist mode or by pointing out the mistakes only. It's by giving solutions wherein the existing system can work better. And politicians are very open to that. If you tell them that, look, I'm going to give you better solutions in a way that you can win your elections with a stronger vote margin, they're pretty open to it. Regarding the woman question, I come from a background of no politicians in my family, IT as well as Carnatic musicians, in fact. And being accepted into this fold of politics has been difficult, yes, but I've never felt it to be a burden. In fact, it's been more of an opportunity. I always tell people that I'm here on my own accord, and that is a really, really big thing to say. I'm not anybody's daughter but I'm not somebody's daughter, and I don't have a famous surname, and I don't have lots of money in my bank account, and that makes me more that humanizes me and makes me more appealing. And also, the fact that I have to fight this on my own means that I know the problems of my country. I have traveled, and I might just be 24, but I've been as much as I can at this age, and that has worked to my advantage as opposed to a disadvantage. I'll just quickly like to talk a little bit about...
We are running short on time.
Sure, but the social entrepreneur bit that Harsha was talking about, there are three mantras that I always tell anybody that I speak to with respect to social entrepreneurship. Disruptive leadership. We cannot be social entrepreneurs unless we look at a problem and say, okay, marginal change, fantastic, but how do we disrupt this entire system to ensure that people's lives get better? Institutional change, whether you like it or not, whichever side of the political ideology you belong to, building institutions is key to building a country. And institutional change means that all of us in this social entrepreneurial gambit have to work together to build different sort of institutions. And the last one is measurable outcome. And this is where a for-profit and not-for-profit really stands out. That a lot of non-profits can sustain without really measuring their impact, because it sounds like it looks good to do good stuff. But in order to sustain as a for-profit, you really need to measure the sort of impact that you're doing. You need to be sustainable. There's not going to be some godfather giving you money just because your cause looks good. So these are the three things that I always stick to and would okay.
Thank you. I think the time is almost up. So I'll just quickly go around the whole panel. In a minute each, if you could answer these two questions with your perspective. One is, how do you see the social entrepreneurship ecosystem evolving in the next 3 to 5 years? And secondly, what would be your advice to emerging social entrepreneurs, starting with Kanika?
I think one thing that I've learned switching from the corporate sector, comfort, cushiony life, to a social entrepreneur for whom every single day is a new day and a new learning, is that it's very, very, very important to listen. If you do not, and I think Yogesh, you also touched upon this, that but out of all that you touched upon, I can tell you for a fact as a practicing entrepreneur, if you cannot listen to people around you, if you do not have the appetite to unlearn and then learn again, you will not be able to bring value to yourself first, to your organization then, and also to your stakeholders. So I think as an entrepreneur, you're actually getting out of your comfort zone, and that also means that you have to really unlearn a lot of things that you've known in the past. So please be open to listening. That's the key message that I would say.
Yeah, thank you. Shankar?
I just want to ask, how many here in the audience even want to be social entrepreneurs or are on their way? Okay. So 1 year ago, if I were to ask this, who wants to be a Flipkart, I think everybody may have raised their hands, right? The point is that we just need to make companies that are as aspirational as an Apple, right? Why can't a social enterprise be as aspirational as Apple or a Google?
You see that happening in the next 3 to 5 years with all this Skill India and Stand Up India and all these other...
Yeah, I mean, irrespective of that, whether that came or not, we can still do it, right? Like, you know, why don't you provide value? Make money. Like, there's no harm in making money, right? But make sure you provide value for it. Like, the companies like Uber and Google and, you know, the big guys provide value, and that's why they charge. And there's no harm in doing that. Mm. And just make social entrepreneurship, like, aspirational and make it sexy, you know? And in 3 years, you'll see something. You'll see more people raising their hands.
Right. Deepak.
So first of all, for all the people who raised hands, happy to help you guys. Reach me out on Karma Circle. That's one thing. The three advice that I have for people who want to go into social entrepreneurship, one is that, you know, be in it for the long haul. Like, it's extremely painful. It's not something that, you know, you should do it for money. You should, you know, and I will tell you that as you, when you start the journey, you should dedicate like next 10 years to that journey and say that, you know what, I'm going to do this for 10 years and unless I fail again and again for next 10 years, I'm not going to give it up. So that's the first thing. The second thing is, because you have to be in it for a long time, make sure that you don't increase your costs significantly and continuously create value. So you should not be like, you know, buying value, which is what, you know, many of the companies which are in for-profit world today are doing, which is like they are actually raising a lot of money and then they're actually buying value. And you know, so that is something that you cannot afford to do in a social enterprise. And the third thing is that do it only because you are truly passionate about it and this is something that you want to do before you leave this world. So if you are actually like, you know, in it for the long haul, you want to leave a legacy before you leave this world, and you believe that you can do it frugally, you know, that is, you know, the advice I have for the social entrepreneurs.
Thank you. Harsha.
Till the time we don't stop looking for jobs, we won't be able to create jobs. So let's think about and focus on creating jobs. And advice to the upcoming social entrepreneurs, pursue your dreams, passion, and inner voice. And you'll reach your goal, not necessarily 3 years break even, it may take you 5 years, 10 years, but just be persistent on it. You may have to mold your business model here and there, tweak, turn it, just keep on going. Thank you.
So I'm just going to answer this question with a specific example of my domain. So I became a political entrepreneur because I couldn't become a politician right away. So there's something making an opportunity and making it a sexy opportunity, because I think that there are a lot of problems to solve out there and we need to really imagine social entrepreneurship in fact, as not just a way to make our lives better, but imagine for it to be a way in which we make everybody's lives better and the world a better place. So if you are passionate about any issue, any cause, it can be anything. It can be as absurd as politics, right? So whatever it is, find a problem that you think can also help you make some money and solve the problem. And their market is always there. Simple basic economics will come to your rescue. Where there is demand, there will always be supply. And there will be supply. So this is my advice to social entrepreneurs, that just look for problems. They're everywhere and don't shrug away from them. Solve them.
Thank you. And before the second bell, I think we've finished on time. And I thank you everyone for such an engaging discussion. I think lots of aspects were discussed about social enterprises. I now throw it open to the audience for questions. Yes.
So Vikram, we can only take two questions.
Two questions. Professor Chaudhary.
Not just one, a couple of questions. Common question is, on the talent front, you might be getting passionate people, they may be low on management skills. You may get great management skills guys, low on passion. How do you balance? That's on one. That. To Surbhi, political entrepreneurship versus political strategic consultancy of the Prashant Kishore type, what's the difference? And to Harsh, I just wanted to ask Harsha, is there social return on investment mechanism applied or consultancy available in India?
So I can take the talent question. So interestingly, I was actually doing the check boxes when Dr. Velumani was speaking, and you know, a lot of things that he talked about, like no house, no car, and very little things. I, you know, that applied to me as well. And so I was like, okay, great. And then I saw on his slide 98% freshers, and I was like, wow, this is great. We are also there. And so we end up hiring people, you know, who are actually freshers. Now, the problem that comes along with it is, like, you know, when they are freshers, how do you get people to train them? And that is where we get a lot of consultants. So we have been very, very fortunate wherein people will look at Karma Circles and they'll be like, wow, such a beautiful concept. I will donate, like, you know, 10 hours of my month for you. And that is, you know, and we compensate them with equity. And by the way, we never offer them equity upfront. They have to first do the good karma, and then they just get a mail from us, you have earned some equity in the company. And so we are very fortunate that, like, people who we could not have afforded, like, you know, people who make as high as, like, you know, $20,000 to $30,000 a month are actually offering their time for free and helping us train our people.
Okay. Yeah.
Also, I think management skills can be taught, mastered. Passion can't. So I think that answers.
Agree with that. Absolutely.
Yes.
Shant Kishore. Okay. I wouldn't say that there is a set definition for what political entrepreneurship is. In fact, in the West, there's a lot of there are a range of political entrepreneurs. But I'd like to just separate what we are doing from what Mr. Prashant Kishore is, and we as well as a couple of other organizations. So, political consulting, election consulting, is essentially reaching, you know, a target in terms of how many votes you want to gain, running somebody's campaign, a lot of branding and marketing related. The problems that we're trying to solve is governance related, is politically, it's political innovation to help governance become better. So that's the difference. And also not as politically motivated as Mr. Prashant Kishore.
On SROI, well, in India, there are hardly 3-4 companies. When you look at the billion number of companies registered, maybe doing sustainability reporting and so on and so forth. So we have done SROI studies for Alert India Foundation, which caters to leprosy-affected patients, and for Omkar Builders.
Yeah. Hi, I'm Ritesh. My question is to Shankar. Shankar, first of all, Sundar Pichoy looks like you. So that's a...
Not the first time I've been told that.
And congratulations for 75 rejections. I think you're the richest man in this room for sure. You have great experience in terms of investment exploration. My question is, what inspired you to do what you're doing?
Actually, I can't take credit for that. It was my co-founder who had this idea about 2 years ago. In July 2014, we've been in, like, just, I mean, so basically I can't take credit, but I'll just tell you about it. I've been in touch, we've been friends for the last 5 years now, and the minute she got this idea, she called me. She was in Gurgaon and I was in Bombay. I'm originally from Bombay. So she called me and she said, you know, I have this idea. And I was like, great, like, you know, let's, you know, why don't you just run it by a few people and, you know, see what people say. I think it's a good idea and let's carry on. So I, and also, like I said, I was there, like, at every point of the story, right? Even though we were at, you know, different cities, but I was there, and, like, every step was more and more and more inspiring. And, you know, I just said, okay, in September last year, I said, okay, screw it, I'm done, let me come and join full time. So that's what actually happened. So what happened was, she was on a trek to one of the mountains in the Himalayas, and just something, you know, like they say about the Himalayas, just something comes to you. And she was just wondering how people with disabilities would do something like this. And then just one idea kind of led to another, another, and then we start, like, explored, like, where the opportunity is. And you know, this is some one place where we thought that there is a huge gap, and that's why we wanted to fill that, and that's what it is.
Thank you so much, everyone, for you know, keeping to time, and wish you all the best, each one of you and your enterprises, and lesser rejections, I hope. Yeah, thank you.